So in this presentation today, I'm going to be talking about the formation of mid-latitude depressions, or what we also call as extratropical cyclones, in the topic for meteorology for marinas. All right. So extratropical cyclones are also known as mid-latitude cyclones or wave cyclones. And in many books, they are also known as mid-latitude depressions. So if you go into any book for meteorology, you will find all these topics covered in probably one section or one chapter, because they are pretty much very similar to each other. So let's get started with the formation of the extratropical cyclones, and I'll start with where these mid-latitude cyclones tend to form. So if you see, or what you see on your screen is any development or strengthening of a mid-latitude cyclone is actually called a cyclogenesis. There are regions of North America that show a propensity for cyclogenesis, which include the Gulf of Mexico, the Atlantic Ocean east of the Carolinas, and the eastern slope of high mountain ranges such as the Rockies and the Sierra Nevada. For example, when a westerly flow of air crosses a north to south trending mountain range, the air on the downward or leeward side tends to curve cyclonically. All right, so this curving of air adds to the developing or strengthening of a cyclonic storm, and such storms that form on the leeward side of a mountain are called lee side lows, and their development is called lee cyclogenesis. All right, so this is just an example. So another region of cyclogenesis lies near the North Carolina, near Cape Hatteras, where warm Gulf Stream water can supply moisture and warmth to the region south of a stationary front, thus increasing the contrast between air masses to a point where storms may suddenly spring up along the front. And these cyclones are called northeasters, which normally move northeastward along the Atlantic coast, bringing high winds and heavy snow or rain to coastal areas. But I'll keep going and I'll talk about what causes depressions. And there are a few theories around, but the most popular theory is the polar front theory. And I'll also show you a diagram and what happens in a polar front theory. So the development of a mid-latitude cyclone normally begins along the polar front. The polar front is a semi-continuous global boundary separating cold polar air from warm subtropical air. Now, because the mid-latitude cyclonic storm forms and moves along the polar front in a wave-like manner, the developing storm is called a wave cyclone. Now, if you see the next diagram, I have shown, or rather it can be seen that the stages of a developing wave cyclone are illustrated in the sequence of surface weather maps. Now, what you see on your screen shows a segment of the polar front as a stationary front. It represents a trough of lower pressure with higher pressure on both sides. Cold air to the north and warm air to the south flow parallel to the front, but in opposite directions. This type of flow sets up a cyclonic wind shear. You can conceptualize the shear more clearly if you place a pen between the palm of your hands and move your left hand towards your body. The pen turns counterclockwise cyclonically. Under the right conditions, a wave-like kink forms on the front, as you can see in B of the diagram, part B of the diagram. The wave that forms is known as the frontal wave, or an incipient cyclone. Watching the formation of a frontal wave on a weather map is like watching a water wave from its side as it approaches a beach. It first builds, then breaks, and finally dissipates, which is why a mid-latitude cyclonic storm system is also known as a wave cyclone. In part B of the diagram, you can show the newly formed wave with a cold front pushing southward and a warm front moving northward. The region of lowest pressure, called the central pressure, is at the junction of the two fronts. As the cold air displaces the warm air upward along the cold front, and as overrunning occurs ahead of the warm front, a narrow band of precipitation forms that you can see as the shaded area, or the shaded green area on your screen. Steered by the winds aloft, the system typically moves east or northeastwards and gradually becomes a fully developed open wave in 12 to 24 hours, that you can see in part C of the diagram. The central pressure is now much lower and several isobars encircle the wave's apex. These more tightly packed isobars create a stronger cyclonic flow as the winds swirl counterclockwise and inwards towards the low pressure center. Precipitation starts to form in a wide band ahead of the warm front and along a narrow band of the cold front. The region of warm air between the cold and warm fronts is now known as the warm sector. Hence, here the weather tends to be partly cloudy, although scattered showers may develop if the air is conditionally unstable. Energy from the storm or energy for the storm is derived from several sources. As the air masses try to attain equilibrium, warm air rises and cold air sinks, transforming potential energy into kinetic energy, which is the energy of motion. Condensation supplies energy to the system in the form of latent heat. And as the surface air converges towards the low center, wind speeds may increase, producing an increase in kinetic energy. As the wave or the open wave moves eastward, its central pressure continues to decrease and the winds blow more vigorously as the wave quickly develops into a mature cyclone. The faster moving cold front constantly inches closer to the warm front, squeezing the warm sector into a smaller area, as you can see in part D of the diagram. In this model, the cold front eventually overtakes the warm front and the system becomes an occluded front. At this point, the storm is usually most intense with clouds and precipitation covering a large area. The point of occlusion, where the cold front, warm front and occluded front all come together, can be seen in part E of the diagram and is referred to as the triple point. Notice that in this region, the cold and warm fronts appear similar to the open wave cyclone, as in part C. It is here where a new wave called the secondary low will occasionally form, moving eastward and intensify into a cyclonic storm. As the center of the intense storm system shown in part E gradually dissipates, because cold air now lies on both sides of the occluded front, the warm sector is still present but is far removed from the center of the storm. Without the supply of energy provided by the rising warm moist air, the old storm system dies out and gradually disappears, as you see in part F of the diagram. Now you can think of the sequence of a developing wave cyclone as a whirling eddy in a stream of water that forms behind an obstacle, moves with the flow and gradually finishes down or vanishes downstream. The entire life cycle of a wave cyclone can last from a few days to over a week. What else contributes to the formation of a mid-latitude cyclone? Then we have something called the concept of jet streams. Now, what are jet streams? So, if you think about it, the necessary ingredients for developing mid-latitude cyclones, firstly, is a role of the jet stream that we'll discuss here, and then I'll also talk about the upper air support. So, in order for the mid-latitude cyclone to develop and intensify, there must be upper level divergence above the surface storm. The polar jet stream provides such areas of divergence. The axis of the polar front jet stream pretty much coincides with the position of the polar front. The region of strongest winds in the jet stream is known as a jet stream core or jet stream. When the polar jet stream flows in a wavy kind of west to east pattern, a jet streak tends to form in the trough of the jet, where pressure gradients are tight. The curving of the jet stream coupled with the changing wind speeds around the jet streak produces regions of strong convergence and divergence of air along the flanks of the jet. Since the air above the storm is being removed more quickly now, then converging surface winds can supply air to the storm center, the central pressure of the storm starts to drop rapidly. As surface pressure gradients increase, the wind speed increases. Also, the high pressure area, a region of converging air, feeds air downward into the anticyclone. Hence, you can find that the polar jet stream removes air above the surface cyclone and supplies air to the surface anticyclone. As the jet stream steers the storm along towards the north or sometimes the northeast, the surface cyclone occludes and cold air surface surrounds the surface low, as we saw before. Since the surface low has moved out from under the pocket of diverging air aloft, the occluded storm gradually fills as surface air flows into the system. Since the polar jet stream is strongest and moves farther south in winter, we can see why mid-latitude cyclone storms are better developed and more quickly moving during the colder months. Then we can also talk about the upper air support. So with the onset of baroclinic instability, horizontal and vertical air motions begin to enhance the formation of a cyclonic storm. As you see in the figure here, the flow aloft becomes disturbed. It begins to lend support for the intensification of surface pressure systems as a region of converging air forms above the positions on the surface of the earth. So you can see that regions of warm and cold advection are associated with vertical motions of air. Where there is a cold advection, some of the cold heavy air sinks, and when there is warm advection, some of the warm light air rises. The sinking of cold air and the rising of warm air provide the energy for a developing cyclone, as potential energy is transformed into kinetic energy. Further, if clouds form, condensation in the ascending air releases latent heat, which warms the air. The warmer air lowers the surface pressure, which strengthens the surface low even more. So now you will have a fully fledged middle latitude cyclone with all of the necessary ingredients for its development. Eventually, the warm air curls around the north side of the low and the storm system occludes, as we have seen before, and you can also see this is showing the formation in the southern hemisphere, what you see on the screen. Some storms may continue to deepen, but mostly do not, as they move out from under the region of upper level divergence. Additionally, at the surface, the storm weakens as the supply of warm air is cut off and the cold, dry air behind the cold front is drawn in towards the surface low. Sometimes an upper level pool of cold air, which has broken away from the main flow, lies above or almost directly above the surface low. Occasionally, the upper low will break away entirely from the main flow, producing a cutoff low, which often appears as a single contour line on an upper level chart. So as you can see here on your screens, what you see is a formation of a middle latitude depression in the southern hemisphere, where in figure A and B, the front is separating warm subtropical air from cold polar air with a wave beginning to form. We've discussed this before, so I will not take you again through this. And then from C to F, as wave develops, a low of increasing intensity forms around it. But as the cold air starts to overtake the warm air and starts to fill in the low pressure center, the front quickly turns into over a period of 7 days, turns into a occluded front and may slowly, gradually weaken and die down. You can also see on your screen here the weather associated with a frontal depression. As you can see, that depending on whether you are approaching or going away from the frontal depression, you will encounter or experience a different kind of weather. If you are experiencing a onset of a cold front, you will experience more rapid and intense rainfall, which will affect the visibility on ships. If you are, it will last maybe shorter time, but if you are approaching the warm front, then the precipitation will last longer, although it will not be as intense as the cold front precipitation. So visibility will be reduced, but not to the extent of when you approach a cold front. And warm front precipitation lasts much longer, it is less intense, but a cold front precipitation is very intense and may be just a passing shower or quickly pass over, depending of course on the strength of the cold front and how long you last into it. So not all depressions are associated with fronts. We also have some non-frontal depressions, one of them being the thermal depression, which is caused by strong surface heating over islands and peninsulas in summer, or over inland seas and lakes during winter, where land is very cold relative to the water surface. We also have the instability depressions or polar depressions, which are caused by surface heating, where a cold polar airstream crosses relatively warm ocean. Latent heat is released when warm water vapor condenses, produces an area of low pressure. And finally, the orographic or lee depression, which occurs due to the air blowing against a mountain range. And then as it starts to pile up on the weather side, it produces an increase in the surface pressure. However, on the lee side, an eddy effect tends to reduce the pressure and a shallow depression can develop. So as you see in all the three cases, you will have a low pressure develop due to some reason and that low pressure or the condensation or the formation of clouds that produce the latent heat then provide the energy to this low pressure to turn it into a mid-latitude or a non-frontal depression in this case. Depressions often occurs in as families of depressions. So they are normally occurring in frontal waves in families of 3 to 4. Like I said before, some of them, once one occurs, it lasts over a period of say about 7 days or 5 to 7 days, and then it die down, and then it is followed up by the second or the third depression, often known as the secondaries, which actually trail along the edge of the extended cold front from the previous depression. Each depression follows a course to the north in southern hemisphere of the one before, as polar air pushes further and further equatorwards to rear of each depression in the series. Eventually, polar air forms a large wedge of high pressure which terminates the sequence as we learned before. So what you see here again is showing you how the upper air divergence and the jet streams aid in the formation of mid-latitude depression. But you have to notice here that the core of this mid-latitude depression is always warm air filled with slowly filling with clouds which provide the latent heat. However, it is surrounded by the cold air which slowly start to, or high pressure which slowly start to take over the warm air and fill up its core cold air. Occluded front occurs when the cold front catches the warm front and lifts it off its surface. As you will see on your screens here, you can see this is a cold front catching up with a warm front which has led into a occluded front. So the occluded front is designated by triangles from the cold front and semicircles from the warm front, both drawn in the direction of the movement of the front. You can see at the core is the low pressure, but here the low pressure is almost dissipated. The front has almost died, although it is still moving. It may be followed by a second depression later on. Now we've talked about extratropical cyclones and tropical. We've talked about extratropical cyclones, and you must have heard of cyclones or hurricanes in the past, or tropical revolving storms in the past. So let me just quickly distinguish what is the difference between extratropical cyclones and hurricanes or tropical revolving storms. Now a hurricane derives its energy from the warm water and the latent heat of condensation, whereas the mid-latitude storm derives its energy from horizontal temperature contrast. The vertical structure of a hurricane is such that its central column of air is warm from the surface upward. Consequently, hurricanes are called warm core lows. A hurricane weakens with height, and the area of low pressure at the surface may actually become an area of high pressure, normally above 12 kilometers. Mid-latitude cyclones, on the other hand, are cold core lows that usually intensify with increasing height, with a cold upper level low or a trough often existing above or to the west of the surface low. A hurricane usually contains an eye where the air is sinking, while mid-latitude cyclones are characterized by centers of rising air. Hurricane winds are strongest near the surface, whereas the strongest winds of the mid-latitude storm are found aloft in the jet stream. The hurricane has no fronts and is smaller. However, there are some similarities between the two systems as well. Both are areas of surface low pressure with winds moving counterclockwise about their respective centers. Some northeasters may actually possess some of the characteristics of a hurricane. If I remember correctly, there was a powerful northeaster during January 1989, which was observed to have a cloud-free eye with surface winds in excess of 85 knots spinning about a warm inner core. Moreover, some cold polar lows or lows that develop over polar waters during winter may exhibit many of the observed characteristics of a hurricane, such as a symmetric band of thunderstorms spiraling inward around a cloud-free eye, a warm core area of low pressure, and strong winds near the storm center. So as I was showing you before, you can see here the cold front is slowly catching up with the warm front, and over here it starts to form a mid-latitude depression. Why I'm showing you this is because tomorrow when you, as mariners, you are studying weather maps, this is what you have to look out for apart from the other details as well. As you see on your screens here in the center itself, you can see that the cold front has now caught up with the warm front. There is a low pressure very close to that, and what will happen is now the low pressure will become part of the core of this front. This is like a mid-latitude depression involving fronts. And as it deepens, you can see other cold fronts from behind are also catching up and may fill up this mid-latitude depression with its cold air, leading to its gradual weakening. But as you see the cold and the warm front interacting, and as the front becomes deeper, there is intense rainstorm and precipitation which may affect the visibility if your ship is around. But what happens is that every time a cold front comes in, although it gradually weakens the existing frontal depression, the cold front may catch up with an existing warm front and form another depression. So there could be a series of such depressions, and if you are transiting as a mariner with your ship in these areas, you may experience continuous and frequent and intense rain showers, of course depending on the direction in which your vessel is going, but your visibility will be reduced. And these are some of the things that you have to look out for when you're studying the surface map. So these are actually extracts of actual surface map, and that I am trying to show you here so that you can put or relate the theory of mid-latitude depressions that we studied today along with the practice at sea.